The fear has subsided here in Bitcoin land as investors once again see the pump is alive and well. And that's because Scamtember has ended and Uptober hath commenced. Now, of course, we did tell you about this ad nauseum. I saw the reply guys after reply guys. No, this is 2018 all over again. It's a bear market. Look at the charts. I'm so right. Well, guess what? The charts are a lie. Just like this pump is a lie and that dump was a lie. You can't focus on the charts. You need to be focusing on where fundamental value is being created. Have a thesis, bust out those diamond hands, and do not sell if you think it's going to go up. Again, this is not financial advice. This is how I do it. And this is how I've made transformative wealth here in crypto and how you can too. Nonetheless, you got to understand the risks are altcoins can go down 90%, Bitcoin can go down 85%, and NFTs can go to zero. But right now, there's no doubt in my mind that we're looking at the next leg up, whether we go down and test into the high 30s or mid 30s before we moon. I don't care. What I care about is that Q4 is going to be it for this bull run. Historically, the year after the halving, Q4 is where all the magic happens. And so because history, as well as price action, as well as fundamentals are all stacking up and aligning here, I have no reason but to be ultra long right now. And I'm telling you exactly how I'm going to invest, how I've been investing, and the people who have been riding along with me, I know because the message is day after day of the amount of gains people are getting from this market. So strap in today. We're giving you not only my outlook, but coins that I know or I believe strongly are about to pump significantly. Make sure you smash that like button. And of course, if you guys want to be ahead of the game, literally no other channel has given you as many gains as this. I've been giving you winner after winner here in NFT land, which has been the biggest winners over the last 3-4 months, as well as picking some of the best altcoin performers over the last 6 months as well. The point is I use my entire team as well as putting in 8+ hours a day to bring you the best content in the business. And I'm always digging for information, even when I'm not doing content officially. And I do this all to empower you with the tools to succeed here. So make sure you subscribe if you want to make transformative gains here in the market. Again, no guarantees here, but that's my goal and what I want to give to you. With that said, let's dive in here. What we've seen here is that extreme fear has faded. And now we're turning back to greed. This is what happens in crypto. If you remember back in 2018, there was a tweet by Joseph Lubin that marked the bottom of the bear market. And he literally almost on the day called the bottom of the bear market, saying, look, it can't get any more fearful than we are right now. Fear is what drives this market to pump, and greed is what drives this market to dump. It is the human emotion rubber band here. You and I are the ingredients here in the market, in all these crypto markets. And that's why when things get way too greedy or way too fearful, there's a rebound. So understand that emotion is the way to trade this market. In my opinion, that's how I do it. I don't use any of these fancy indicators. I trade based on emotion. And when things get really, really fearful is a great opportunity typically. And what we're seeing here is traders think 45K is the bottom. That's not what matters to me. What matters is that we're in Uptober and new highs November. And of course, followed by deliverance December. Again, I'm going to be selling probably pretty heavily in November. If things get as euphoric as I think they might be, we'll get to that at the end of the episode. Smash like if you want this step-by-step strategy that I'm putting forward for you. Now, what I wanted to go into was this, which is a very important thread by 6529. And I was like, do we even know who 6529 is? Is this Mark Cuban? I feel like this could be like a Chamath, maybe, or he's just some Bitcoin OG. He talks a little bit about his history here. I'm going to read through this thread because I published this tweet this morning saying, you're wrong, period. You're wrong about NFTs. You have no clue how big this will be, end tweet. But I didn't know that we had gotten this incredible tweet storm thread from 6529. I'm gonna read through it because you need to hear this. On NFTs 2030, this is the type of mindset that creates absolute champions. The people who flip and dip for a new Corvette are not going to make it into the Citadel. You understand? So however bullish you are on NFTs, you are wrong. You are insufficiently bullish. 6529 has gone to the mountaintop and there is almost nothing in life that he is as sure of as this. Now, first, the usual anti-FOMO advice. The rest of this is a gigable NFTs in general as technology. This does not mean that you should ape into the PFP collection silver snails. Most individual NFTs are headed to zero. Of course, this is a really important point is that there's such a parabolic supply increase that most will go to zero. So to say that all NFTs are gonna go up is not the point of this. It's not the point. Back to the main event. 6529 first came across BTC in 2011, 2012 and ignored it. It was not until August 2013 in my apartment in New York City that I actually engaged, read the white paper, downloaded a node, bought a BTC, and sent $20 of BTC across the world instantly. It was an instant teleport to the future, but a very broad, expansive future. Solving the Byzantine general's problem allowing for decentralized consensus is not a discovery that leads only to permissionless wire transfers or even digital gold or even uncensorable payments. All of those things are super important, and the OG Bitcoin decentralization maxis with their full nodes and paper wallets are providing an invaluable public service, keeping a global independent payment rail open and running. They are sentries on our societal frontier. I believe this as well. But that is not the end of it. That is the beginning of it. Modern society runs on databases that are run by TTPs, trusted third parties. What are these TTPs? They are literally everywhere. Citibank, Google, Facebook, New York City, etc. Your pension fund administrator, the IRS, the NSA. For modern society to function at its current scale, for you to function in it, to travel, to earn money, to vote, to get a cab, requires thousands of databases to track you. It's not evil. It's a function of this is the only way we could do it. In that context, the trusted third party is who decides in practice your rights, from trivial to important. It can be as basic as a hotel reservation being canceled to whether or not you can wire more than $100,000 into your crypto exchange in a day to whether you are allowed to vote in a presidential election. We take it for granted because it has faded into the background of our lives, but databases run by TTPs rule everything around us. Memes are the apex object of society, but the architecture and machinery of society in 2021 is an Oracle or Amazon database. Okay, so what? So what's the big deal with trusted third parties? There is a macro and micro problem. The micro problem is that they tend to be anti-competitive. Computers lead to economics of scale and data infrastructure, so firms tend to grow. And as they grow, they build a huge installed database of data and data infrastructure. That is the main competitive barrier to entry in any modern business. This is why the antitrust regulators know that there is something problematic with FANG, but can't find it. The answer is not to force them to lower their prices. A lot of them are free, or try to tell them which products they are allowed to build or not. These are 19th century solutions to a 21st century problem. If 6529 was ever going to be a regulator and had to solve things in the traditional way, there is a simple solution to these issues. Force companies and governmental agencies to provide a first-class access to underlying data. The market will solve the rest. The macro problem with trusted third parties, the macro problem, is the increasing centralization they provide that is increasingly creating easy chokeholds to hijack the whole society. People have a hard time thinking about this in an abstract term, so we need to do examples. Imagine taxis 10 years ago, a fully decentralized industry that knew effectively nothing about their customers. Uber was a revolution and really convenient, but a future dictator can trivially ban 6529 from Uber, Lyft, etc., but Mission Impossible stopping him from a taxi. The same thing applies to the FANG. They are amazing businesses, and I use their products daily. They have bought tens of trillions of dollars of utility into our lives, but they can be hijacked by people with guns. 6529 thinks that the state worries too much about day-to-day risks and not enough about existential risks. Day-to-day risk, crime, drugs, money laundering, tax evasion, terrorism. Existential risk, dictators. I'm sure there was crime and tax evasion in pre-Hitler Germany, in pre-Stalin Russia, in pre-Mao China, and none of these things caused 1% of the deaths, economics, and cultural destruction that was caused by the hijacking of the machinery of the state. Those who would give up essential liberty to purchase some little temporary safety deserve neither liberty nor safety, is one of the most important things ever written on this matter. It is, of course, important to try to reduce day-to-day societal ills. 6529 is not in favor of crime. Neither am I here. Elio Trades is not a supporter of crime. But these efforts are double-edged swords when they open the door for the edge risk of someone hijacking the whole system. This is an attack vector that, especially in these corona times, we've seen more and more authoritarianism by the government. And now we're seeing that we are more and more controlled by systems that can be completely hijacked. It's actually a very scary thing. 6529 is worried that the world is sleepwalking into high centralization systems with literally nobody pushing the other side of the equation. China is already over the transom, and sadly, USA and EU are headed in the same direction. We see this. We see conversations about programming the future CBDCs so that they can only get spent on certain goods, or that you can't buy more than this many dollars of alcohol. Whatever the prescription is from the government, they tell you soon what you can do, where you can eat, where you can drink, where you can sleep, and what you can think. So to to recap, BTC solves decentralized consensus. Centralized consensus is everywhere. TTPs cause micro problems, anti-competitive, and macro problems, existential risk. What does this have anything to do with JPEGs? So this is where it gets fun. I hope you guys have enjoyed this theoretical intro. And just because I'm reading this and using this as a talking point doesn't mean I am 6529 or that I agree with everything he says, but I find this thought process, this thought exercise extremely compelling, and I wanted to bring it to you. Starting with 2013, 6529 has been harassing everyone he can find, including himself, that we can now build on decentralized social systems. And yet every year since then, 6529 has been quite disappointed at what decentralized systems we have built. The reason is that crypto has been highly financialized. So the infrastructure has become centralized, exchanges, etc. Tons of good ideas are securities violations in the USA, including many ideas that 6529 would have done. So what do our JPEGs have to do with this? A, they are decentralized. They are constitutionally protected free speech. They can represent the nuance of the world, which is non-fungible, not fungible. They can be used to build decentralized social organization. Now, D is where things get very interesting. So here he puts out this map, which I actually think is quite cool, which essentially shows here we are in 2020, and here we have this path to 2030. Where we are right now is we're moving past collectibles into art, and then we're going to hit gaming. I've been telling you about gaming. Gaming is where NFTs go totally mainstream. But then, of course, this is the first mainstream consumer product. Eventually, we'll have more sort of hardcore, serious use cases. Obviously, brands and culture, but then we get metaverse, off-chain assets, off-chain governance, the deed to your house, the ability to vote, the possession of very important rights and access, those types of things, especially as smarter cities and IoT technology starts to exist all around us, protecting those assets in the form of a non-fungible token makes total sense. I was having a conversation with a VC that believes that financial data and cookies will be the form in which NFTs kind of take over and the most commonly used form to actually store internet data. It's all very interesting stuff, but just know this is still, as much as I believe gaming is the mainstream wave here, I believe that it is still a stepping stone to a fully NFT society. I know that's crazy to say, but it's going to be huge. I've been banging the table about this for 4 years. And we continue. The addressable market for NFTs is not a subset of the art market, but in the first phase, all societal intangibles. These represent tens of trillions of value and are the coordinating mechanism of society. It is obvious that NFTs are the internet moment for art. The art establishment is going to get flipped because it's behaving exactly as conventionally and any other incumbent. It is amusing to see in this creative counterculture field. But one massive mistake people make, including some of my best friends in crypto, including 2011 to 2013 OGs, is thinking the scope of NFTs is art. After they flip an art, NFTs will start eating brands. They will start eating culture. They will start creating decentralized alternatives to centralized orgs. Are Bored Apes silly collectibles, or are they a decentralized competitor to Supreme? I've made this comparison several times already. We do have our Supreme here, and it is Bored Apes. So that will be the next phase. NFTs will be used by companies and decentralized organizations to organize their communities. Unlike customer databases, they are public. They are composable. They are uncensorable. They solve both the micro and the macro problem with TTPs. If they want to go to provide some service to the Bored Ape Yacht Club community, I don't have to ask permission of Yuga Labs. I can just airdrop to the holders or use BAYCs as a mint pass. This solves the micro problem with TTPs, no antitrust regulators needed. On the macro side, if I were a potential dictator, same problem. I cannot easily freeze the movement of BAYCs because they run on Ethereum, not in the customer database of Yuga Labs. It is vastly more difficult and impractical problem to chase down everybody individually than to freeze, of course, the central choke point. That's what everyone would do if they were in the place of trying to restrict freedoms. They would freeze a central choke point, like freezing a bank account or something like that. But how do you freeze Ethereum? The whole point of this is that you can't. And this, of course, goes back to my belief that Ethereum NFTs will be the most valuable NFTs. There will be amazing NFTs all over, but the ones that exist and are protected by the security of the Ethereum blockchain are the ones that will, in my opinion, thrive. And that's why I'm very bullish, which we'll talk about on what I just found out here about Immutable X and TikTok. We'll get back to this. And this intermediate stage, in time of our metaverse of persistent digital objects, will become more and more real until it becomes a default reality. This will also run on NFTs and will be our default reality. critical to be decentralized. Then comes the stuff that is less interesting conceptually to 6529. We'll bring movie tickets, vacation rentals, hotel reservations, home sales, and so on into NFTs. Yes, of course, it'll be good for market efficiency, but off-chain assets will require trusted third-party linkage to come on-chain. So these bringing you your Cancun rental on-chain will solve economic efficiency problems in the normal way, but not any fundamental problems of liberty or societal organization. I agree. This is why I am personally bearish on off-chain NFTs. I've said this many times that real-world NFTs have a huge counterparty issue in my mind, and that's why I'm not focused on them. So it's great to see this alignment with 6529. By the way, all of this points to where the next angle of system attack will be on crypto. That is non-custodial wallets. Both the USA and EU are floating different attacks on non-custodial wallets. This is the only regulatory battle that we must win. I totally agree with that. If we don't have the ability to store our crypto assets ourselves, then effectively we capitulate into a state of centralized control, and that completely upends the entire crypto revolution. This is a point that is probably the biggest point in here. We can concede on everything else and still win. Whether DeFi governance, a token X is a security, who cares? We simply need to maintain the right to hold crypto directly, not in a TTP, and transact reasonably without insane record keeping requirements. If we can preserve this, which is not a one fight, it is a fight that has just begun. Coin Center, Niraj, 2-Bit Idiot throwing everything at this specific topic, then JPEGs can take us the rest of the way to Valhalla. We can absolutely organize decentralized organizations with JPEGs without violating any securities laws. And if we can do it, then the magic of the network, the collective intelligence of humanity, will take us the rest of the way. This is what 6529 is here for. I like the art, and I like making friends, and I like ooh and aahing over beautiful art, and I like it when ETH number of my NFT holdings goes up. But I like those things in a normal way. Like, I like going to a nice dinner. The reason that 6529 is laser focused right now is that there is a narrow window where we can bend the arc of history, where we can change the path of world history. I have not felt this way since 2013, when 6529 played a small role in BTC's development into what it is. This is enough for today. Read this, absorb it, read it again. It is the underlying theory. Take a day or two to digest it. Go back to other threads, read them, and in a couple of days, I will explain my plan. I actually had a whole bunch of more news I was gonna cover today, from some play to earn coins like UFO that have been pumping. We brought you this about 200, it's about 535 now, so over 2x gains there. I wanted to check back on some of the NFT calls I made, just to sort of underline how crazy the gains are here. Looking at Anonymize, which is now up to 5.5 ETH per mouse. Again, I told you guys about this, I think around 1 ETH was when I first started talking about it. And most importantly, we see Immutable X, a project I've been talking to you about since earlier this year, getting TikTok to do their first drop on IMX. It is massive. Massive news. Immutable X is going to be a protocol that completely eats up the NFT mainstream market. Keep your eyes focused on this space. Now, with that said, I want the thoughts that are expressed by 6529, one of the most prolific NFT investors and clearly a thought leader that you must be following here to understand the gravity, the importance of the NFT and how it will affect our society. It is one of the most profound things we've come across in quite some time, and my bullishness for this space seems to be unending. Now, that said, it doesn't affect my strategy. Q4, I'm going to be taking a lot of profits because, like many things, even if 10 years from now JPEGs run the world, there can be nuclear winters in between now and then. So I want to be prepared to buy the blood. I want to have tons of liquidity on the sidelines. And so as NFTs are looking like they're about to break out into mania mode right now, I'm going to be taking some liquidity off the table towards the end of October, smashing it into my favorite altcoins, and then preparing to take a bunch of bacon home for winter when it comes to the end of Q4. Of course, I'm gonna be doing some tax optimizations, making sure that I have the proper amount of money set aside for taxes, and that I have plenty of dry powder ready in case we go bear in 2022. Again, I'm not hoping we do that, but I'm preparing in case that is the case. With that said, I hope you guys enjoyed this. If you liked the path down the rabbit hole of NFTs, smash that like button. And remember, nobody's putting you further ahead in NFTs, which is the most profitable sector of crypto, than this channel. So make sure you subscribe with that bell notification on. We're gonna be coming at you nonstop with time-sensitive information to help you get ahead and stay ahead of this market. With that said, I'm Elio Trades. You can find me on Twitter at Elio Trades, and I'll see you very soon on the next episode.